thought we had a great conversation about starting the master plan at the last meeting, and I'm excited to pick up there again. Maybe we'll get a chance to do so tonight. But if not, then we're gonna have to all kind of use our knowledge about using the website in John's absence until he comes back. So I think that's it for comments from the chair. I don't really have a lot to add, so let's move on. Item 4, general business. Comments from the public about something not on the agenda. There's no members of the public here, so we can move past this item to public hearing. Item 5, again, there's no members of the public, but this is the public hearing on the proposed zoning regulation fixes. We'll open the hearing now officially. This process.
Correct.
Yep. And what I propose we do is we keep it open. We talk through the memo you sent us. We talk through any other issues related to the zoning. We keep it open as we continue through our agenda, and then we close it at the before we adjourn for the evening, just in case members of the public arrive later in the evening. How does that sound, everybody?
That's great.
Sounds good. Okay. All right, so Mike, do you want to kick us off here? You have a consideration of council recommendation to limit development on steeps. Oh, right, Kirby added this. Kirby, you attended the council meeting. First of all, thank you for doing that on our behalf.
You're welcome.
So, just want to say thank you because we all kind of put our eyes down. And so how did it go, and what did you learn?
It went really well. Mike did a great job, as always, of explaining things, and it was relatively quick. The only substantive feedback really was from the new council member, Lauren, right?
Lauren, yep.
And she had concerns about how we apply or how we deal with, now that we're going to allow building on steeper slopes of 30% or more, how will we nonetheless kind of contain that? And it's related to a lot of the conversations we had with Barb's concerns and the buildable area, even though this wasn't, that part of it wasn't even before city council yet. It was just about us allowing with the engineering plan for there to be some building. But we've already had some discussions about that, and so some of what we talked about is related to her concern, because she wanted to see some kind of standard or something that goes into the regs that can be applied to kind of like contain things. And what she had thrown out there was, you know, this you can build on these slopes if it's not feasible to build somewhere else, is kind of along what she was saying. But feasible, for us lawyers, we know that that can be pretty strict. You can interpret feasible very strictly to say, because almost anything's feasible, physically feasible. So I had mentioned that I thought that was a little strict, and that we could maybe come up with a different standard that gets at what she, because she's getting the same things that we talked about. But we just got to figure out what the right standard, what the right words are for that. Something to add. And I don't remember the section number, but if you remember, there's like 14, 15 things there. So we'd be adding one more thing that's kind of a standard to apply when they're considering to give a permit for these slopes. And again, this particular standard, since we're talking about the steepest slopes, would only be applied by the DRB. It wouldn't be through the administrative permits that Mike gives out, because you can't get one of those permits for this. Does that everybody understand where we're at?
Yeah, I think I need to. Mike, do you have
what
section number is?
There is the 3007.
Oh, okay.
Which I will mention really quickly. You'll notice a couple of highlighted pieces. So these came out of the discussion. Now that the slope rules were adjusted, permits have started to come in. And Public Works had some comments that they wanted to see inserted. And so starting at it makes a little bit more sense as you start to see it. So in the purpose statement, they wanted to add protect development on or near slopes and to limit disturbance and clearing. Before it just said limit disturbing or clearing of slopes. And the reason why we've got to kind of adjust it a little bit is we're now allowing some development on slopes. So one of the things they're looking at is not just that the slopes are stable, but that what is going on the slopes are also safe.
Mm-hmm.
So we could have a, so they're going to be looking at foundations of buildings, not because the foundations of buildings affect the slopes, but because buildings built on steep slopes should have engineered foundations that keep them on their slopes.
So maybe that wording is a little bit,
mm-hmm.
it could be revisited, because protect development on or near steep slopes to me makes it sound like we're trying to keep what we have built on slopes rather than ensure safety.
Yeah, if there's better words, this kind of came up late in the day today, so I kind of had to put some things together. So as you go through, you'll see these, and once you see the whole picture, if you think there's a better way to do that.
Okay.
So again, with applicability, it had said before just disturb or clear, but this section will point B.
3007.B, okay.
So point B is applicability. This is what needs to get a permit. Before it was just disturb or clear land. So if your land was already cleared, but you wanted to build a house on your already cleared land, you wouldn't have to meet this rule because you're not clearing, although somebody could argue that putting the foundation in will disturb the land. The idea of this is if you're building on those, you're going to need to meet these requirements. A little bit farther down in E, the requirement for the hearing is not just disturb or clear, it's also develop. F used to say grading plan. We changed it to engineered plan because that's the way the rest of it, rather than having, this is talking about
mm-hmm.
grading plan, and then later on we talk about engineered plan, it's the same plan. So,
mm-hmm.
you know, use one word for the same thing. And then an applicant shall not propose to develop land in excess of the limits established in 3-9 unless the applicant submits to the Development Review Board, approves a plan signed and sealed by a professional engineer registered in the state of Vermont. The plan shall address such items as existing and proposed grades, foundations or retaining walls, drainage and swale information, a written statement from the engineer indicating that the project will not have an adverse effect upon slope stability. And those were the pieces that the engineering department downstairs wanted to see. When somebody brings them
yeah.
an application to review, those are the types of information they want to see. And then the design standards in H were adjusted to read that development on steep slopes shall be safe and not have an undue adverse effect on the slope stability, period. Development, therefore, shall be designed to. So there was an addition that reflects the safe. And maybe the purpose statement didn't
mm-hmm.
reflect it as well as I think this captures it better
mm-hmm.
than the way I worded the original. So those, anything is highlighted, were suggested additions for tonight. These were not in the original, and these would be to reflect those concerns that Public Works had in administering the rules.
Mm-hmm.
So that's just a preamble. There's
mm-hmm.
also this other discussion, same set of things
okay.
from council about what can we do. I suggested to council there are a couple of things.
So I just want to, hold on, I just want to yep. zoom out a little bit and make sure I understand what the two different buckets of concerns are that we're looking at
mm-hmm.
as pertains to steep slopes. So what we just went through are the engineering department's requested changes to the language to ensure that they get what they need.
To administer, yes.
To administer, okay. Then the other set of information or concern we're talking about is from City Council, the thought about what kind of standards we're going to have on restrictive development on steep slopes.
Yes.
So beyond this, the engineering plan, that's not enough. We might also want to put restrictions.
But it's actually good to do this part first.
Yeah.
Because we could talk about how these changes to 3007F, they kind of hit a lot of the same things as what we were
okay.
the other thing. So we can talk about after considering that, we can talk about whether we think we still need to add something.
Okay. So you had some thoughts, Mike. Thanks for letting me. Just want to make sure I knew which topic was.
Yeah, so they're kind of two pieces, and then those 1 to 14 on H was where Kirby was mentioning maybe we could add another piece in there that would might go and capture this idea of, you know, where other viable locations exist on a parcel. Applicants shall, should utilize those locations first to the maximum extent feasible. It's not the greatest way of doing it, but it would.
Do people want to develop on slopes when there is other? I mean, I just question. I mean, I understand her point, but I just wonder how often is that going to happen? Somebody is drawn to, you know, do something with a slope when they don't have to.
Or that language would change their mind, right?
Yeah. Or
it doesn't seem like it would do much.
I see this clarifying that we do have a preference. I mean, it's hard to look at all of these rules and not see that there's a preference to not build on steep slopes.
Mm-hmm.
But adding clarity is not that bad, as far as I'm concerned.
Can we just say that the city has a preference that, or is that, I don't know, legally is that?
A preference isn't something that the DRB or anyone could really hold you to.
Oh, okay.
But if we put in a standard that actually puts some teeth to it, saying that.
I mean, we could do it in two places. We could have it in the purpose section. That would kind of be the best place to articulate preferences, but then having a rule that can implement that preference in some way would be, you know, sort of the ideal way to cover it in the rules.
But so what I was thinking about with subsection F here is that it lays out all of the different things that have to be in an engineered plan. And I think we could use that as a way to show that if you're going to develop on a slope that need to meet certain things. I think has a lot more substance than just a vague, like, we would prefer if you not.
Yeah, that's a lot more concrete, if it's there, to me, than trying to put something in under 14. That seems a little more like a preference, unless something you could actually hold someone to.
Yeah, I think that they might accept that, as long as it's. My question about this section that the engineers want is, I'm not seeing where it clearly allows them to deny a permit based on these things.
Well, it's like point F would be what they're expecting in the application. Point H would be where we would be.
Okay.
Denying. Those are the standards. So the engineer plan is giving us the information we need to determine compliance with H.
So is the, I guess it depends. So the such items as piece at the end of that makes it sound like, is that if applicable?
It sounds like a guideline recommendation.
Right. It doesn't sound concrete. So, the plan shall address such items as, makes it sound like you can address some of these things.
Yes, I agree. That language should be changed.
And I think the reason it was worded like that is because not all projects will have foundations and retaining walls. Not all projects will be.
So maybe as applicable instead of.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's any more concrete, but.
I mean, they can.
I would just say the plan shall address colon.
Yeah, I would too. Mm-hmm. I would get rid of such item as, and when the plan can say this item is not applicable, and that addresses it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I see that all the time.
To get back to your first comment, Leslie, I think, in the first sentence, changing protect to allow.
Mm-hmm. This is in the purpose section on 30078.
So was the intent to allow safe development?
I used the word appropriate.
The section is intended to allow appropriate development?
To permit appropriate development. It gives some flexibility. I think I think the idea is if you comply with F and H, it's appropriate.
So what was the verb?
Either permit or allow, I don't think it matters, but.
I'm gonna say allow.
We prefer to use the word allow.
Yep.
Just because permit tends to confuse people between whether we're.
Do you need a permit?
Permitting
it, right, exactly.
Permit,
no,
or allowing it permit.
And I was wondering if it makes sense to define steep slope in that purpose statement. On or near slopes with a 30% or higher grade.
Who can say
steep
slopes as defined in C?
The C that defines steep
slope.
That's what I was looking for. There's no.
Need some tweaking too.
It might be worth defining steep slopes in the definition section.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the only place I saw it in this section is maybe it's an H, which seems odd. Bury it that far.
Yeah,
it's
kind of part of the figures. But yeah, we should.
Okay, so maybe purpose, the section is intended to allow appropriate development on or near slopes.
I think we can just say steep slopes, provided that we insert a quick definition
okay.
of steep slopes in C.
Yeah, I think if it's defined in C,
yeah,
it will be.
Yeah, I just, I.
We need to add it there.
Okay, in context.
Here.
So what I would do for C is, for the purpose of this section,
we have two
the
subparts.
Following definitions, and then
mm-hmm.
the following definitions apply.
And so what would you define as steep slope? So it would be steeper than or equal to 30%?
15%. Because 15% is where we start.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Greater than or equal to 15%. Okay. So, do we want to add something in 14 or in H.
I'm looking. We could add it to sub 2, because that's the big change we're making. And
where?
H sub 2.
Oh.
That's where we said not create, because we used to just say not create slopes steeper than 30%, because that was sort of the policy goal.
Mm-hmm.
We've changed it to equal to without an engineer plan. It seems like. A logical place to put it would be another sentence after that, saying, like, kind of qualifying some limitation on that.
Is this the consideration of feasible or appropriate development sites?
Right.
Well, I feel like it's probably better to be standalone, just so we don't muddle the issue. Because they're two very separate directives.
What's the separate directive we're talking about?
One is don't build on slopes of 30% or more without an engineered plan, and then the second consideration is whether or not the applicant or the developer has considered the feasibility of developing on other appropriate sites on the parcel. I don't know what the wording would be, but,
mm-hmm.
but I think they're distinct enough that they probably deserve separate. Bullets.
Yeah, I don't have strong feelings about it. We can do a separate one.
Does everyone feel do we have consensus about adding something at all? I mean, before we get into the nitty gritty.
I'm struggling to understand. I mean, we've laid out the standards you need to meet, so I'm struggling to understand. It's sounds to me, I mean, maybe I'm misunderstanding, like we're protecting against someone who's would meet all the standards of building on steep slopes, but for some reason would just like want to put it on the steep slope. I mean, is that what we're protecting against? And it seems
maybe for aesthetic reasons, maybe someone would. So I
maybe,
guess if you're
okay.
because I see what you mean about is this practically, is it going to come out
right.
in a practical way? Maybe.
Somebody wants to put a deck, they're near the edge, they're going to put a deck that extends out, and they're going to put some footings down so they can get good views of the valley.
Yeah.
And they're going to meet all the engineering standards, and we say, yeah, but you've got a side yard over there that's not steep, you can put your deck over there.
Right.
And
but it wouldn't be attached to the house, so that's where they
or it would be attached to,
yeah.
it could be attached to the house, but just
not
over
okay.
the views.
But yeah, I think it just it gives the developer or it gives the city an opportunity to sort of push back on some design and at least force the developer to articulate why. So, I mean, all they could say is, well, that wasn't feasible for this reason. And the town
because the project purpose is to build on a slope.
Right, and the town can decide whether or not that's, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And, there,
that,
and there
that
was...
That really is feasible. But I think it just gives a layer. It just gives another sort of data point to evaluate the project.
Vis-a-vis ever come up.
Yeah.
But if it does, having that hook available might be nice.
Okay, well, the deck example is a helpful one. Yeah. I hadn't thought of something like that.
And somebody pointed out at the council meeting that, you know, what was being proposed was something that kind of went counter to what was the purpose, which was to have, you know, protect against erosion and protect the structures on the slope. So we can engineer and do that. Just because I have some other land that's not steep, you'd really have to have a different reason for why, you know, why wouldn't I be allowed to build my deck over the steep slope if I'm meeting all the engineering standards. You know, you'd need to have a different reason for having these rules. You'd have to add something in, whether it's an aesthetics reason or some other reason, you know, just because I have options and I could put it not on the steep slope. That's more of an aesthetic reason why I wouldn't be. That was the argument that the gentleman made to the council.
In a lot of ways, what they've asked us to do is really tricky. I mean, it's because we can try to break it down whether it makes economic sense, but there's also other reasons. So it's almost like we have to come up with for what reasons could a person build on a slope when they don't need to.
And officially our task was to consider what the comments were. I don't think we received any directive from council that we would make changes to reflect that, but we were going to consider the counselor's recommendations to look into that. So,
okay.
Just so.
Well, we have a couple members of the public here, so I thought I'd
just observing.
We are having officially a public hearing.
Yeah.
So.
I thought I'd turn the call.
Oh, it's okay.
No, I want to thank you for your thoughtful deliberation on this. You know, because like a lot of people, it's just this going, okay, I know that you're going to revisit the...
Joe, sorry to...
Sorry.
I don't want to invite you up so people at home can hear you.
Oh, sure.
The chairs are...
Joe Castellano, Sabin Street, Montpelier. I was just curious just about the 30% slope discussion, and I just wanted to find out where it was going and what direction the Planning Commission was interested in taking.
Okay. We will continue talking about it
okay.
then.
Not easy.
Yeah. What do we want to do tonight with this? I mean, we can invite Tina up when she comes back, but I don't know if we feel like we want to try to put some language out there to think about, or we want to wait?
Well, I don't necessarily want to put us down a rabbit hole, and we don't have to do this, but I guess when sort of considering all this, the thing that comes up in my mind is whether or not the commission, just as a broad prerogative or perspective, thinks that we should have a preference to against developing on steep slopes. And if we do, what are those underlying reasons for it? Because I think that'll help inform how we consider the comments from the city council meeting, and whether or not we need to make more changes. I mean, I think this discussion about feasibility, if it's even really necessary, it's a good discussion, but I don't know if we're ever going to make headway with it unless we really just sort of drill down into say, like, what is really our preference here, and why does that preference exist if there is one? And that might take a long time to discuss or not. So, like I said, I don't know.
Well, a lot of possible concerns are already addressed. For instance, it's already clear that if it's going to cause safety issue or structure issue, that it's not going to be allowed. Is that right, Mike? Is that right? Safe to say?
Yeah.
So what the other things that we could get at, we could just throw something more generic out there, just because the council asked us to do this. We could throw in, and I'm just going to put this language forward just to move us along if possible. We could put a standard in saying, the way this list is set up, it says, development shall be designed to, and then add one that says, avoid development on slopes steeper than 30% if financially practicable. That's at least something for the DRB to look at.
So we're tying this to somebody's...
That the DRB could say, you need to put it elsewhere, unless it would just cost too much.
Okay.
Yeah, I guess I'm just concerned, like, is DRB going to... I don't know what their deliberations are like, but it seems like you could do financial calculations in several different ways, and then it gets more controversial.
Right.
I'd just be a little bit concerned about that.
If I have a lot of financial resources, I could build whatever I want.
You could just say, take out financially practicable and just put practicable.
Yeah.
It's more vague, though.
But it's a little better than feasible.
But it kind of goes back to the question. So, like, if the reason why we prefer development away from steep slopes is safety, fine, completely valid. But the question becomes, what does adding another subpoint under here, how does that address it? It just seems to me that the concern is safety. You've got somebody who's got to put a PE stamp on an engineering plan to ensure safety, and I'm just going to assume that an engineer who's going to look at building on a steep slope is not going to put his professional licensure on the line and build something that's unsafe. I mean, that's just... So I think that sort of takes care of itself. But I guess I still don't understand what the root driver of sort of codifying a preference against developing on steep slopes.
I don't think any of us can answer that.
Yeah, I mean, so.
I think that Barb might have opinions on this, but other than that, I don't think any one of us really feel. I mean, I don't have any aesthetic preferences. I don't feel qualified to have them. And as far as requiring a PE. The safety of it, then.
Yeah, I'm just sort of. I keep being. I'm drawn to Ariane's perspective on this, which is, I mean, what's the practical,
right?
Impact.
Well, when we start, if you remember the debate with Barb over buildable area and her concerns there, and I think if there is an obvious preference to not build on the slopes. That's, I think, part of Barb's concerns. Her other part is basically that currently the steep slopes are limiting the number of units that can go in places, and she likes that, which most of us haven't agreed with that perspective. So it doesn't get at that, but it does get at the being able to throw up new units willy-nilly in some of the neighborhoods that have a lot of steep slopes.
Sure, but is that the commission's position? I mean, I think that's... The issue is like, we're a body, and opinions about it, but I think as a body, we have to make a decision about whether or not we're going to worry about this stuff. Just right now, the list seems fine. I'll just say, the list seems fine right now. I don't think we need to add anything to it. I think it seems to hit all of the, the pieces that I think are, the standards that I think are fine. I think you're right. Why would you build on steep slopes if you don't have to? Maybe there's a reason for it, but I don't know that it.
If they avoid the steep slopes, they're going to save themselves the cost of hiring an engineer.
Right. Exactly. I think that's a very good point. There are significant costs, and I'm sure that there are significant costs of developing on a steep slope that you just don't have on a flat ground. And so, unless there is some sort of overriding concern that we have, I don't see why we wouldn't just.
So I'm wondering about Mike's experience. What have you seen in your experience with people wanting to develop on steep slopes?
For the most part, well, we didn't have any regulations on slopes before 2017. So this was newly added 2018, and now we're going to kind of adjust it now in 2019. And for the most part, when people came in to do stuff on slopes, it was usually impacting pieces of a slope. Nobody was kind of going in wholesale. But markets change, times change. I was a planner in Lamoille County for 8 years, and Stowe spent a great deal of time working on their ridgeline zoning, but theirs was for aesthetic reasons, because that was the best place to put your McMansions and just, build the road along the ridgeline and plunk out all the biggest houses along that ridgeline. And so they were attacking it for a different reason, for aesthetics. But here, I haven't seen a lot of it except on the edges, people trying to get in to put something.
And that's with no regulation on, no restrictions on
slopes.
No
restrictions. And the ones that we have had, even once the rules came into effect, were relatively minor projects.
So that sounds like it supports Ariane's assessment that this probably just doesn't happen that very, very much.
So it's like decks, sheds, additions, stuff like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I mean, Ward Joyce's project that's on Berlin Street, Dunkin' Donuts, Domino's, and there's that new one that's going in there.
Mm-hmm.
So that backs up to a 30% slope. He couldn't push that building back any farther because it was going to start to, you'd have to either remove ledge or build into the 30% slope that was back there. So there's a project at the bottom of a hill that would be impacted. There was Sibley Street, which was up top. They were generally staying away from the slopes, but there was going to be the impact of the structure at the top of the slope and the stormwater and erosion control plans for where the water was going to get diverted for the affecting that. Berry Street, the college property, the discussions that were going in, the project had pretty much gone away at this point, but the initial discussions was to have a cottage cluster maybe in that part that would have walkouts on the first floor and walkouts on the second floor. They would build into the slope so that way you could, each side would have that. So it's not necessarily building on the top of a hill like out here, but it's kind of building into a hill from the bottom up.
Well, Aaron's
of the Shire.
let's do Hobbit holes. Aaron's convinced me. I think it's possible we could go. I do feel like I feel a little bit of an obligation since I was there at City Council, and I was like, oh, we could do that when they proposed this. I feel like going back and saying, we don't agree with you. Isn't the best, but
I don't think it's that we don't agree.
But I think that this addition that Mike's talking about that Public Works wanted that says that they wanted this language to be safe and not have an undue adverse effect on slope stability. That covers a lot of what the feasibility standard, I think, would get at. So maybe if we could go back and say that this change gets at meeting what we were kind of charged by the city council to do. Try that. I would be in favor of that.
What do others think? Good with that approach?
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that.
See if we have any comments from the public on this thought.
I have not been keeping up with this, and I don't feel well informed. But I think we had good reasons for protecting the steep slopes, both for the slopes themselves and for the people below them,
mm-hmm.
and for judging what was buildable land. And I think those were all good reasons. And so I don't know where we are now, but if there's going to be greater permission to build on steep slopes, I wonder if it could be crafted so that if the department, if the planning department felt that the slope from the Mylar maps felt that the slope was over the steepness that it was meant to be, over the percentage, if the builder could show the applicant could get a professional opinion that it would be safe for whatever reasons, that maybe that way it could be overcome, but it would be less general than just saying no steep slope.
Yeah, that's what we're doing, actually. So, comment noted and apply. But, I think the challenge was that the planning department office didn't have the capabilities of judging the slopes, and so it was sort of the approach we've taken is to require a professional engineer plan for anything from 15% and greater. And what we're looking at right now are, I don't know if there are any
more. Well, the engineer plan's required over 30%.
Over 30%?
And it's required depending on the disturbance size, that's what figure 3.9 is. So the figure there
over
is
30%.
So 4,000 square feet of 15%, 3,000 square feet of 20%.
Okay, so these standards limit the disturbance that anyone can, any disturbance on slopes from 15% upward. But to build on a slope, you need an engineered plan once you're 30% and greater. Thank you, because I didn't appreciate the distinction.
Yeah, or, I mean, if you're doing... Yeah, I think anyone who gets into the engineered plan requirement is going to have to meet all the engineered plans. So you'd have to look at foundations. If you're doing 4,000 square feet of 15%, that's going to boot you into the engineered plan requirement. The engineer plan requirement requires those pieces.
All right, so walk us through this. So in figures 308 and 309, we've got some thresholds. Can you just, I think maybe I wasn't fully appreciating all of the thresholds for kicking into different levels of review. So if you wouldn't mind the tedious exercise of walking us through, it would be helpful.
So engineered plans originally were 8,000, 6,000, 4,000, and then not allowed. And we adjusted them, so now you need engineering at a much smaller project.
Mm-hmm.
So now we require... With the proposed amendment, we will be requiring engineered plans if you're going to disturb more than 4,000 square feet in that slope category, 15%. And then it goes up to 3,000 square feet and then above 20% and 2,000 square feet. So these are still going to be difficult for us to administer, but we also have a bottom, a floor. So if somebody's going to come in and disturb 900 square feet, we know the only thing we've got to worry about is the 30% rule, because of just the way the rule, just based on the amount of the traffic. And then if it gets over these other requirements at 8, then there's a public hearing where neighbors get notified.
Joe had a comment. You want
to
come on up?
Yeah,
I'm sorry to ask that of you, but it is very helpful.
I just had a question for Mike. I know that there was a second handout that I picked up, and this is based on, it was dated February 20th, 2019. It was from Kirby Keaton and Barbara Conry. And I know one of Barbara's concerns was just, you know, as we're revisiting this, that some of the proposed changes were going to allow for greater density. But it sounds like with the engineering plan, Mike, if you have an engineer out there to assess the lot, they'd be able to quickly identify what part of the lot is over 30%. So that would eliminate the concerns about density or unbuildable or challenging areas to build on. Am I correct?
They're definitely related, but two different ideas. The issue that comes up with the buildable area is it will always apply to any application that involves changing of adding a house or doing a subdivision. And that's where we were having more difficulty, is even small projects where somebody was coming in to go from a 4-unit to a 6-unit, we could say, oh, you've got enough density for that. And it's like, well, we actually have to go through and calculate how much area is not buildable to decide whether you can put 2 more units in the carriage house that's on the property. Those were the issues that we were having with the buildable area. Because people would have to, even though they're not developing on a steep slope, they'd still have to hire an engineer to come in, do the topographic survey to determine how much steep slopes there are. Even if you're not affecting any of the steep slopes, you'd still have to get the engineer. And that was why we said we recommended eliminating the buildable area requirement for that and for a couple other reasons. But that was related, but slightly different.
Yeah, I think the policy reason behind requiring an engineered plan has been to ensure safety, and that, you know, anything that is built on a slope won't affect the neighbors down below or you know, cause any sort of issue. So the way that the buildable area analysis was playing out was that was also triggering a need for an engineer plan every single time there was an assessment about density. So we took a hard look at that and how the other footprint requirements, size scaling requirements, control how any given building will fit in the context of a neighborhood. And we were satisfied as a majority, not unanimously, but as a majority, that would accomplish the policy goals about that the limiting density based in the buildable area was looking to do. So that's how we came up with the recommendations that we have now.
Okay.
And hopefully that explains what you're asking.
Yeah, I was just a little curious because I said it seems like we have possibly two conflicting things. I just wanted some clarification.
Yeah, they're so interrelated.
It's
confusing.
Thank you.
Tina.
I have a question. I'm sorry I didn't do this before. My name is Tina Ruth. I have a question about what's the effect of the engineering plan. Is that not automatically you produce a plan and it virtually has to be approved because there's a plan? Or does the DRB actually look at the plan and question it?
So the way it's worked so far is we get the engineered plans, and because we're not engineers, we send it over to the Public Works Department, who reviews the materials, and they make recommendations for various things. So we have had them on a project on College Street require soil borings because they wanted to know about where the bedrock was and whether the foundation of the proposed house would be properly fixed to the bedrock. So they had to provide soil borings, and Public Works reviewed the proposed foundation. They actually denied the foundation proposal, gave them alternatives. They came back with an alternative foundation proposal that was approved by Public Works. So yes, to a certain extent, by the time it got to the DRB, there was an application and a letter of support from, or a technical review by the engineer, which basically concurred that yes, we have reviewed this and find that the foundation will be.
So just to be clear, you're not asking about the substantive standards for reviewing a proposed development. You're talking about questioning whether the plan, whether the engineered plan itself is accurate.
I'm questioning whether, I just wanted to know how it was evaluated, and
mm-hmm.
Mike has
mm-hmm.
answered that.
Yeah, the DRB will have preference on these 1 through 14. So there's some things in here that aren't technical. Preserve distinctive natural features and general topography of the site and existing natural vegetation. That's number 3. The engineers aren't going to be looking at that. The DRB would certainly, and if there's a comment from a neighbor that goes and says, we really want to see that vegetation there maintained. Some of, you know, the standards can be a little bit, give more room for the DRB to provide input on.
Mm-hmm. The way it's written, it says for engineers, it says an applicant shall not propose to develop land in excess of the limit established in figure 3-09, which is the engineer plan required table we were just talking about, unless the applicant submits and the DRB approves a plan signed and sealed by a professional engineer registered in the state of Vermont. The plan shall address, and we're getting rid of such items as, which is there right now, but, and then it lists existing and proposed grades, foundations and retaining walls, drainage and swale information, and a written statement from the engineer indicating that the project will not have an adverse effect on slope stability. So they're really just technical pieces in nature, but it sounds like, staff will review that and comment to the DRB if there's any concerns about the accuracy or methodology.
Yep.
Okay.
And the other thing that Public Works wanted was an erosion control plan, but that's actually section 3008, which also requires erosion control plans on all projects affecting slopes more than 25%. So we didn't add that recommendation in because it would be duplicative of the next section that they have to meet anyway, so.
Okay.
Just so you know, there is a separate erosion piece that would also be addressed.
Okay.
Well, this might be kind of silly, but I'm looking at 3007F engineered plan since we're looking at it. The second subpoint is foundations and retaining walls. I'm assuming the engineers are the Public Works wants to know about the structural integrity of the foundations and retaining walls, as opposed to, should we just add that to be clear? It just seems odd. The plan shall address foundations and retaining walls. It's not clear what specifically they were seeking.
So for point 2, add in structural integrity of?
Yeah, I mean, I'm assuming that's what Public Works wants.
Mm-hmm.
I read that as just the existence of.
Right, that's what I'm unclear about. Do they want to just know that there are walls and foundations, or do they want to know that, I'm assuming they want, as part of the PE plan, that those foundations and retaining walls that are being proposed for development have structural integrity that satisfy Public Works. It's just unclear to me what it is they really want. That's
right.
The existing and proposed grades make sense to me. The drainage makes sense to me. The engineer narrative makes sense to me, but the foundation's retaining wall is not clear.
Yeah, maybe Mike, you mind just following up with them to ask them if they're looking for either structural integrity or existence of.
Yeah, how about we just for now insert the word structural details of foundations and retaining walls. I'm just trying to think about how I usually see these engineering things come through.
Yeah, I defer to you. I don't know.
As long as the language that whoever's preparing and whoever's reviewing understands.
Yeah.
Just to throw that out there, foundations and retaining walls and their structural details. That's a way to phrase it.
I'm good with that. There may be a mild tweak based on what Kurt has to say. Better way of wording it.
Yeah.
Sorry to keep nitpicking at this, but I just want to, since I've been staring at it for a while.
Nitpicks is where we end up what ends up happening is we adopt these things and it's the the nit that we missed.
Is 3007B, it references figure 3.008, should that be 3.09? 3.8 is the hearing, 3.08 is the hearing threshold, whereas the engineer plan threshold is 3.09.
I actually don't think we may need that anymore.
Yeah, it's just, I don't like
because
sure.
We're defining steep slopes in C.
Yeah, okay.
That exceeds the thresholds as we could put that exceed the threshold amounts specified or defined in subsection 3007.C.
I think it would still make sense to refer to the figure 3.09 because that outlines what the thresholds are as a matrix between slope grade and disturbance. So,
okay.
I mean, the notion is below 4,000, you can do it on 15%, down until you hit 30.
And I think the original, just to understand the context, before we flipped the numbers in 308 and 309, 308 had the lower threshold numbers, which was why that probably referenced 308, because that would have been the lowest of the thresholds. Now 09 is, so that's a good catch.
And sorry, I have one more question, which is on sub H. Given what we have in figure 3-09 now, subsection or sub 2, not create slope steeper or equal 30% with an engineering plan, it seems a little misplaced because I think it seems like that one can be completely taken out. It's sort of because
since figure 3-09 says that effectively.
Yeah, I mean, it just feels like we're kind of addressing the engineer plan in a kind of, it seems like a very separate issue than these other components that are listed in this list.
Do we want to just reference the table for the figure?
I see where you're going. Well, just so you understand, and maybe the 30% is also, we'll see where it goes. So the issue could come up with somebody having, let's say, a property that's 10% slope, and they decide, you know, the Pitkin parking lot behind, right over here. You decide you're going to go through, and you're going to take this 10% slope, and you're going to dig back so you can make your parking lot bigger, and then you're going to make a big steep slope. So you had a 10% slope, you now have a 30% slope, or you now have a 100%, 100% slope because you put a giant retaining wall there. So we have rules that say if you're going to affect a 30% slope, you're going to need to meet these rules. But if you have a 10% slope and you cut out all this dirt to make a 30% slope, you won't have to meet these rules. So the reason that rule was put in was to try to get people, if you're going to make a 30% slope, you should have to meet the same rules as if you're clearing 30% slope. Did I say that clearly?
Yes. So,
okay.
So maybe the way to address that is in the, that is helpful. So in the engineering plan section in F, yeah, it says this, the applicant shall not propose to develop land. Yeah, so that speaks to your, I think that language speaks to that notion, which is even if you have a 10% grade,
develop land or create slopes.
Well, I'm trying to call that propose to develop land that I'm trying to figure out a way to say that results in a slope of those thresholds in 3.09. My issue with sub 2 is that there is a more nuanced and specific matrix in figure 3-09 that I think applicants should be more, should be reliant on as opposed to this sort of broader statement in H sub 2 that just speaks to the 30%. It just seems to me this can be taken out because we have figure 3.09. I'm just trying to minimize.
Yes. And what, so where I'm thinking, following on your thing, is maybe to take it out, take number 2 out. But what we may need to do is to put in point B for applicability. These are things that have to meet these rules. So we're talking about land development proposed to develop on steep slopes, including disturbing of or clearing of land, which exceeds the thresholds on this. We may need a second sentence or to build in there a comment that goes and says, or the creation of
that results in the slope. Development that results in the slope of those outlined in figure 3.
Slopes in excess.
Development that results in slopes that exceed the threshold amount specified in 3-09, figure 3-09. I don't know if that was a complete sentence.
Mm-hmm. Close enough. All right, good catch.
And I'll be quiet.
All right, so you don't have to apologize for catching nits like this.
Oh, but I do.
We're all very grateful for you catching them. Is everyone comfortable with the language in here now? Emery is. well, then I'll volunteer to write a cover letter or something along those lines, just sort of explaining our discussion and rationale. As a creature of the last five, I think. So
I started writing up some just to address the follow up for my part of it.
Okay.
And I was gonna send it to everyone actually.
Okay, well then if you wanna do that and then you can
add to it for the other parts.
Sure.
Is that okay?
Didn't wanna put it all on you, but you anticipated it and already did it. So we can do it together. Okay, so it sounds like these are approved by consensus, but let's just have an official vote. So all those in favor of recommending these amendments to section 3007 with minor tweaks provided by Public Works in 3007.F2. Do I have a motion to make that recommendation? I realize I have to ask it that way.
I'll move.
Okay. The second?
Second.
Okay, so I am and Aaron. Two AKs.
So.
Okay. Any further discussion on this?
I really think we need to do a deeper dive on this one. Spend some more time.
All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Okay. Passes. All right. Do we have anything else for us to discuss? Do we want to discuss the Riparian memo first? Or?
I didn't have anything else.
So these memos.
To go,
we've got, I just want to make sure I understand what our process is here. I know I'm saying that like I'm not the one deciding on it, but it looks like we've got a memo from Kirby and Barb regarding steep slopes and buildable area. We've got this memo that Mike circulated about riparian buffers, and my assumption had been that we wanted to send this with the whole packet.
Yeah, that was
my
thought, was that if we vote to forward this to City Council for consideration, that we would include with it the two memos.
Okay, well let's go through
the three memos now.
let's go through, right, we have to write the final one, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, let's see if we can knock off these memos. So I'm going to kind of jump ahead on the agenda a little bit to the buildable areas memo, because I think that'll be quick discussion. Does anyone have any other changes to this? We've talked about this quite a lot.
Kirby and Barb's memo?
Kirby
yeah.
and Barb's memo.
I didn't change the date, just to give you some background with what you're looking at right here. I didn't change the date, but this was actually from March 13th, was the latest version, and I don't believe that we discussed any changes since March 13th.
No.
But, okay, I just wanted to float that out there in case I had forgotten to add something or do something.
No, and in fact, I think we should change the date to reflect the date that we send the proposal, the whole packet, to City Council when we do that. Sound okay?
Yeah. And I don't.
April 8th for tonight's vote.
Well, yeah. Assuming we just got this one, so I'm not sure that we're ready to vote on the memo you circulated, Mike.
Oh, okay.
Just, I don't know, have people had a chance to review? Okay, so actually, before we go there, everyone's good with the memo that Barb and Kirby wrote?
Yeah, there's a tiny little typo I just caught. It's actually kind of a funny one. It's right under suggested changes right here.
Mm-hmm.
So the density shall be based a lot.
Sounds like Irish or something.
I actually like that typo. It's a better play.
All right, so this memo is deemed approved by consensus with a fix of the typo and the change of the date, which for now will be April 8th. Pending our final date. Okay, moving on.
I just want to, just to clarify, Mike, will you make those changes when you put everything together? Like, I don't need to do that. Everything's in Word and it's not locked.
Or in Word, and the other one is. Ah. Okay.
Okay. Did people have a chance to look at Mike's memo about riparian?
I have not.
Area? Because I haven't either, so that's why I was
Can we just
see.
Take a couple of minutes to.
Yeah.
Okay.
chance to review.
It's a good moment.
Thoughts? Well, first, thanks for drafting this. Yes.
Why is urban core capitalized on the first page, but on the second page, in the last paragraph, it isn't? I don't really know what it is, so it
mm-hmm.
might not be anything, but I was just wondering.
Yeah, that's a good catch. Where's the second reference?
Last paragraph, the end of the first sentence.
Oh, yeah. So it is a, it should be capitalized because it's a zoning district. So thanks for catching that.
And technically should be
urban
center.
I was wondering about that.
Not urban core.
So the UC references UC 3, UC 1, that's all supposed to be urban center 1, urban center 2. Thanks, Emery. Other thoughts? I have some. I'll start. I mean, in the first paragraph, the second sentence, this one has been singled out because it directly counters an item of discussion and compromise during the council's adoption hearings in 2017. I thought maybe we could just get rid of and compromise and just call it a discussion. If others are agreeable, I just thought. Might seem less like
right.
people against
you guys compromise for it, and we're not going to go for the compromise.
Yeah.
The other one I have is on the last page, the second to last paragraph. We have one example of a good project that would be denied. I thought maybe we should take out the subjective adjective good and just say one example of a project that would be denied, just to leave it to the individual to judge.
We don't need to trumpify these things.
Right.
The best example.
The best. The best project that would be denied.
Right. Yeah, exactly. That's what I want to avoid. I just want to be, you know, objective. Here's what we looked at. Here's why we decided this. And try to avoid that. They always creep in when you draft, so having editors helps. Other thoughts?
I think it's great. The one thing I'd say is, this is just from my perspective, and I'm still kind of getting up to speed with a lot of this, but I felt like the last sentence in the last paragraph is a good opening sentence for the entire memo. It does a very good job of contextualizing exactly what we're talking about for the rest of the memo. Just the Planning Commission proposes to remove the buffer requirements.
Yeah, I mean, you could have it at the beginning and then have it again as it's written there.
Yeah, I just thought that was a very concise sentence and really
so
helpful. It took me a little while to just sort of figure out exactly what the specific change. I mean, I know that it's in the ray line of the memo, but that last sentence does a good job of really just distilling what it was.
Repeat up front.
Yeah.
That's just
that's a great idea. Just get rid of the word therefore, and you've got it.
There's a couple minor tweaks, I think, but otherwise.
And then since we're getting into this, I mean, with the sentence where you said take out compromise, I wonder
mm-hmm.
if we want to say, can we also use something other than directly counters? Because to me,
it
would say something more like it involves an item of discussion.
Mm-hmm. We're going to war.
Yeah.
That's great. Yeah, was.
Yeah, I sometimes can be a little more direct than I start everything with a fight. We'll work our way back.
I just think you're being overly honest. It's the way I see it, which is a good
very
thing.
Very transparent.
Yeah.
Any other edits or questions? Okay. Can we just change this date to April 8th too?
Sure.
All right, do I have a motion to approve this memo with the edits we've just discussed?
Motion. Stephanie,
second. Yeah. All those in favor, say aye.
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 All those opposed? Okay.
Thanks, Mike.
Memo is approved. All right, before we move, I seek a motion to approve the, or to move the zoning regulation fixes to the city council for consideration. Do we want to have, give any other feedback, members of the public we have present tonight? Thank you for your contributions. All right, so do I have a motion to propose that the zoning regulation fixes?
Forward proposal to the city council for consideration.
Okay. All right, okay, I'll withdraw that and reword it. Do I have a motion to forward the zoning proposal to city council for consideration? As we've been discussing over the last year. Okay, second?
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion? Okay, all those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? Okay, the motion carries. So we'll forward the packet, which will include the zoning changes, the three memos. Well, we have two memos.
And the third one.
And the third one. Do people want to review and edit that, or do you want to?
Is that something we need to approve specifically?
I think I don't think we do for process, but we can. So if people want to look
see
at it.
At least.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what we'll do is we'll circulate something around as soon as possible.
I'll send my part to you, and then you can circulate.
Okay.
Okay.
I'll circulate something as soon as possible. And then when are you thinking of sending this packet? Whenever it's ready?
Yeah, whenever we've got all the pieces, I'll let Bill and the mayor know, and we can decide. There's going to be a time, there are going to be times. It's usually 15 or 30 days. I always have to look it up in the statute every time before they can warn a hearing. And
okay.
Then they'll probably have a preliminary meeting to review things, because once we warn the hearing, then we're back in that
right.
knucklehead rule that
okay.
As soon as it gets warned, both sets of rules are in effect. And when both sets of rules are in effect, it becomes very difficult to do anything. So.
Okay. Well, let's hold off.
It'll be
we'll circulate something. And give a deadline for getting us feedback, which would probably be about a week. And then incorporate edits. If there's significant edits to incorporate, then we'll recirculate. And if not, we'll just forward it on to Mike at that point. That sounds good.
Okay.
Oh, no, I'm just curious about the. So what was the thing that happened at the city council that you guys went to? Just trying to remind myself of what the process was.
For the interim rules?
Yeah.
So there are a couple of items we expedited for review because
right, okay, thank you. Sorry, I was just forgetting.
Landscaping and the slopes rules, actually, the short version of the slopes rules were approved.
Okay, so those
already,
were already approved.
And
okay,
they're already
right,
in effect.
Thank you for the reminder, okay.
Yeah, there's a lot to keep track of. Yeah. So. Okay, good. Then that's the end of item 5. We can move on to item 6, the city plan. So. All right.
Well, I didn't give you guys these things. Then I'll be ready to. So.
What do you have for us?
Before we hand them all out. I don't know how we'll do this. I'll take one of each and then we'll do the take one and pass it on. Start working that way. So what is going around? So we're talking about this city plan. We've got to continue to work with the session with maps, but what I wanted to provide you was an email, which is now going around. One thing I did not send around was
okay.
The first thing I would mention.
Okay. Here's another extra.
The white paper. And commissioners. So what I sent to Historic Preservation Commission, so they, there's actually a number of commissions and committees that are currently trying to work on some form of a work plan. HPC just happened to be coming up. They were supposed to be meeting tomorrow, but they didn't have, couldn't get a quorum. But I had already prepared some stuff for them to consider, and I put together a memo for Meredith to send, or them, that tends to describe a little bit of a process that I'm going to try to replicate. I don't know if you want to take the time to read it, or if you want me just to summarize it.
Let's just take a minute and read it. Like most people are done. So if you want to just summarize it and walk us through.
Yeah, so what I've been trying to start to work on is, while John has been talking about, you know, the larger picture and the web stuff, is the hard part is actually developing these implementation plans for everybody. And so my thought is just to kind of start to jump in and work with them. We had done, and you now each have a copy of it too, is just, we had put together this implementation plan on, you know, with a silly example of how to make Montpelier have a city filled with butterflies, rainbows, and unicorns, and we kind of, just as a way to frame out how we're going to lay these things out. And so this white paper just kind of explains that. And so that was just meant to be giving them something to see how we're doing it, what we're trying, where we're trying to get as an end point. And so I just cleaned it up a little bit to make it look a little bit more presenting. Before it was just notes.
Mm-hmm.
And then what I started to do for them, which is the other sheet, was to just start to pull together planning ideas, permit ideas, program ideas, project ideas, and policy ideas. Those five P's, how we're going to implement our plans.
Oh, so to illustrate what you mean.
To illustrate what we mean, and to go start to go through and say, all right, here's some things to start to get you thinking. These are some things that a Historic Preservation Commission does for planning. How do they understand? Well, they do National Register updates. They do inventories of structures. They map sensitive areas for archaeological resources. They could record oral histories. They could do a viewshed analysis of state house domes. These are all planning ideas. The question is, what's on their work plan? Some things they've already done. They just updated the National Register, so that's done. But are there other surveys that they think need to be done? And this is kind of putting some ideas out there for them to start to ideas to where they want to try to go. Permit ideas, design review in historic district. If you want to implement protection of historic resources, one thing you would do is have a design review, which we do. But there are some other things, demolition rules, adaptive reuse, you know, there are different permit things. The programs, where we are a certified local government, we are a designated downtown. So it's just this was just a way for me to start to lay out things, and hopefully they'll be able to tell me, yes, this, no, that, and Mike, did you know there's this, and did you know about that, and we think that's a project we'd like to work on, or that's a program we would like to implement to help protect, because eventually what we need to do is get to the end, some thoughts on aspirations. We kind of want to build that, you know, what's our goal for historic preservation? Why do we have a Historic Preservation Commission? There has to be a reason we're doing this, and we've got to have this aspiration and this vision, and then we're going to have our goals, and then we're going to have these implementation strategies, and they all should knit together, which is a little bit of what the white paper tries to do, to put these pieces together. And so this was really just, for me, just the limited amount of it. Knowledge I have of historic preservation and trying to Google other plans and look through other plans, what could I come up with possible implementation tools and some possible goals. There actually are no historic preservation goals in our current plan, so if I had one, I would have put it in there to go and say, well, our current plan is this, or our current goal is this, but we don't actually have one. So that was just some things to start to get them to think, and unfortunately I won't be meeting with them tomorrow night because the meeting got canceled, but the idea is I've got this one. I'm currently working on economic development, and just another one of these little lists like this of what are the different ways we would implement something with economic development, and then to try to work with Laura and Gephardt and the other economic developer folks to try to start to pull together something that would, you know, we've already done housing, we have a housing implementation plan, this would give us historic preservation, that would give us economic development. I know energy has...
Is your thought that these would be sort of appendices to our city plan, or would they be part of the city plan?
They'll be part of it, but they're going to probably be more like an appendix in the end, in the back of it. The thought was, when we first talked about how to build the plan, and John and I were kind of running that conversation, but the idea was, we want to have a very strategic plan. Our goal is to kind of focus this on a strategic plan. We want our plan chapters to be relatively short, you know, maybe they can be part of a web page or something else. But what we really wanted to do is to kind of start with the end, do the implementation plans, and then write the chapters. Most people, when they go to write plans, will write the chapters first, and then the implementation plan is kind of that afterthought. And what we thought is, you know, we could write 30 pages on housing, but what we really want to do, if we only want to have 2,000 words, those 2,000 words are really going to be, why is this our vision? Why is this our aspiration? And really just talk about the important things, and maybe we'll have a white paper that's 30 pages long that describes all the housing data and statistics and all these other pieces. But we really want to get people, capture them, and tell them a story on why housing is important.
But I think we need to agree on, you know, we as in the community, the Montpelier community, at least build consensus or understand what we want, what are our principles, what are our operating principles, and those can be in the forms of goals. But it's challenging to work kind of in the weeds, and then I don't want us to lose sight of the big picture, and I feel like we do need to have some sense of what that big picture is.
Mm-hmm.
And of course we need our implementation piece too. And we should kind of come up with the big picture that we feel is, you know, our guidance based on the information that we have available now, put that out to the public, get feedback on that, and then start developing some implementation ideas that would then go back and help us reevaluate our big picture principles. I think there's going to have to be a lot of feedback loops in this process, and so I just don't want us to feel like, okay, we drafted this is done, because I don't know that we'll ever be there. I mean, we will eventually, but that's kind of how I see the process unfolding. And actually, Tina, you were part of the city plan, the master plan development process previously, right? Would you mind, since you're here, would you mind sharing with us, since we're pretty much all new?
I thought it was a sensational process. They had a list in the back of the plan of literally hundreds of people who participated at various public meetings, large group meetings, and then they had some small committees that seemed to work very hard. I was not living in the city. I was living nearby, but I was not living in the city at that time. And I didn't get involved in any of the small committees, but it was an extensive public involvement. And which is why I felt so supportive of it when it came out, because of that process. That it was very extensive.
So what are some of the examples of how the public was involved? I mean, was it through the committee process, or was there various meetings?
It was led by the staff.
Mm-hmm.
It was led by the office, and they did a lot of preparation. And they had one meeting up at Noble Hall that I remember. We broke up into various groups. Oh, there were just a lot of issues that they covered. And they covered more issues than is sometimes covered in regional and a municipal plan, which was one of the reasons it was so big. But it also was one of the ways in which it really reflected a lot of input from the city.
Mm-hmm.
So they would divide up, and they'd have materials posted around, and you could look at them and evaluate them and say what looked like a good idea and what didn't look like a good idea. And then there was always room for more suggestions as well. And then they would build on those as it went on. So the staff must have worked hours and hours and hours on the preparation and on the culmination of each of those meetings too. So that was one thing that was interesting about it. Another thing that was interesting about it was at the end of each chapter, they had goals and they had, I've forgotten what the objectives to accomplish the goals. And then they had the responsible parties listed, people who they thought would be involved, so that it helped people understand that that was what they had conceived of anyway. So you could go through the list, what goals your organization would be interested in, or your body of the city government would be
mm-hmm.
involved in. And they had time frames for accomplishing things, too. At one point, they started out, I think in the original announcements, they started out with a very long time frame, which frankly to me seemed kind of ridiculous. It was just too far out. But that was substantially shrunk. So I don't think it went out actually any more than about 15 years by the end as to what they hoped to accomplish. But it did realize that some things would take longer than others. I was very impressed. I thought they did a great job. And that the town really responded to it very supportively, because those meetings, the some that I attended, were really attended well. And they broke us up into various groups to kind of work on issues, and then we reported on them, and they took written notes and that sort of thing, and built on it. It was a remarkable job, I thought.
Oh, great. Well, thank you. I've heard a lot of good things about the prior process, but I haven't heard any of the details about what went into it, so it's illuminating.
Well, I don't know about the details either, but because I don't have that good of a memory at this point. But they had a lot of areas that they did. I'm trying to think of an example of some of the things that they went into that plans don't often go into, but quality of life issues that are not land use directly.
Yeah.
But we're good. They were interesting. It was a broader plan, and it got a lot of attention because it was a broader plan. But it was a much more reflective of what goes on in the city too.
Interesting.
And what people wanted.
How well did people think that we acted on the plan during that time period? Yeah, I mean, how much was it used?
I mean, the usual wrap about a plan, I think, is that it's done and it's spread.
Awesome. Well, it's a rare treat to have Tina. Tina Ruth was on the Planning Commission for many years, and it's a rare treat to have her here. So if anyone else has any other questions about them. Yeah, it's hard to figure out where to start with such a big process, but it seems like reviewing the prior master plan, reviewing the updated reports that have been done since then, and settling on an initial set of principles is a good starting place. And what we were doing the exercise last time with the map, where John Adams had the map up on the screen and we were marking various locations in a Google map with pinpoints. I think that process, you're like, oh, there ought to be this or there ought to be that, that helps us kind of, if you think about, well, we want to have a connector trail to U32. Well, what does that mean? We want to promote pedestrian access. That's what it means. So it's the broader goals are really what's underlying some of the ideas that we were placing on that map. So I think looking at the map is helpful in that regard. But
yeah, and I expect this to be iterative. Some of the weaknesses that came out of the previous plan was that it wasn't as strategic as it could be. It did identify groups, but it really didn't. It was more imposed on groups. Oh, by the way, you're doing this, as opposed to starting to work with the Energy Committee to ask the Energy Committee, what is your working plan, as opposed to people in the community telling the Energy Committee, this is what your marching orders are. When we started to talk about updating this master plan, which has been kind of talked about for a couple of years, the initial thought was we had that broad input from the public of what they wanted for the visions. Now we really needed to do just a better job of making it more strategic. And certainly we're going to adjust it and have those public input to make sure that that's still our housing goal, that's still our historic
So
goal.
When you said that we've gotten the feedback, are you talking about the prior master plan?
Yes.
Is there a source of information?
And there was a lot of public input that went into that. And that was a huge process. They had at least 4 and maybe 6 vistas working all at once on that project.
And when was that?
2008, 2009.
Okay.
So it was a very large input process. And so the thought was that most people didn't want to go and replicate that process all over again. But we did want to kind of take that and build on it to make a new thing. In this case, with historic, it was just kind of somewhat surprising that there actually wasn't a lot in there on historic resources. Other chapters, there's going to be a lot more. There are goals. You know, when we talked about housing, there were housing goals. We kind of took the housing goals and said, well, they kind of got 4 of them, and we'll take these pieces out of these to kind of make this as our new housing goal. But I think we still need to, this wasn't meant to replace what John was talking about.
Mm-hmm.
I think
no, I know.
We absolutely need to go and have a couple of different input points coming in as we move forward. But to get the framework that people can add or remove things from, you know, if I work with historic resources over the next 2-3 months, we would have a plan that kind of lays out their work plan for the next 8 years of topics they think are most important. Now we can take that to the public and say, these are the things we think we're working on. What's your thought? What is your maintain, evolve, transform? You know, when we talk about maintaining our historic neighborhoods, what does that mean?
What if we had various maps for various types of priorities? So if we have like energy goals, we have one map that we place little markers for various energy implementation strategies that we're interested in learning more about. And then we take that and to the public, get some feedback on, and we can do that about various chapters or topics, and maybe some topics should be aligned, you know, or integrated together. Like energy and transportation is a good candidate where we really should be looking at this cohesively. and we get some feedback on whether this is the type of goal. I mean, it, because I think a lot of these things have been vetted already. So just getting a verification that people agree that we're still on the right track. And then as we start to put all those pieces together, then we would have the larger public meeting where we're like, this is all of the priorities that we're balancing in the city, and there's going to be some that conflict a little bit, and when they conflict, here's our proposal for resolving that conflict. Who's going to get priority? What do you think? Because we have, I mean, we've got to go out to the public early and often, but also have a plan that's developed enough that we can, people are going to want to take the time to give us feedback, and that's the challenge.
Yeah, you can't just give the public a big white piece of paper and say, tell us what our plan should be.
Right, right.
I think there's like a, there's a cohesive visioning piece though that's missing, so I haven't looked at the 2008 plan in a long time.
Yeah.
So I don't know what sort of overall visioning commentary is in there, but I think that's a piece that if we just dive down into each committee, we miss that. Like,
yeah.
I think that's sort of what you were getting
at.
Yeah,
it is, yeah.
We miss that overarching, what are we most concerned with, or at least some sort of visioning statement that it might be good to get broader input on, so we know all the committees are working underneath that, that same cohesive idea. Like, that would be helpful for me.
Yeah.
I like what you said, Leslie, and I'm going to paraphrase. Tell me if I'm following what you mean.
Make it more eloquent, please.
I doubt it. I'm about to fall asleep. about kind of getting some of these implementation plans, getting some information from the committees, and then use that to go have some public events, one or more, very relatively soon. And but use those as the guidance to kind of like pitch and see what comes back as feedback. I think that sounds like a good near term plan.
And there's some that you say are in pretty good shape, right? Like the energy.
There's more to do on the implementation plan. I think the vision is there. I think to make their implementation plan match our structure.
Who's got that?
Some energy committee, MEAC.
Right, but we don't want to charge them with changing the structure and, you know.
Well, that's what I'll be. This is a little bit of what I would be doing. Is kind of pulling these things together and then working with them.
But I think until we get feedback, we get, you know, the green light from the public, it might not make sense to waste that energy, whoever's doing it. That's what I don't want to do. I just don't want it to be a situation where you're spending, you know, hours upon hours every week trying to work on this product, and then we send it out to the public, and you're like, well, you do it then, you know, not that you would do that, but that would be the feeling that you might have, or any one of us would have. So trying to figure out how to balance this, you know, our resources and our need to get public. That's the challenge. It's really challenging. But maybe this could be a way to do that. So let's see. So we have the information from the presentations we had at the L committee's meeting, and I think that's a great place to look at the visioning piece. Mm-hmm. And maybe the next meeting we can, you know, we can review those materials. They're all in the Google Drive, as far as I know. I haven't actually checked, but we can all review those materials and talk about what we interpret kind of the overarching vision to be with all of those in mind at the next meeting. Does that sound like a good plan?
Yeah, and to maybe look back at the 2008 plan as well. I'm just giving that to myself as an assignment.
Yes.
I need some accountability.
Yeah.
Just a quick question.
Yeah.
But then you guys readopted. Were there any changes in the readoption, Mike, in 17?
There were some. You know, I mean, you'll want to, if you read the 2017 plan, you'll basically be getting the 2008 plan with updates.
Yeah, we revised it to incorporate new reports, information we received from reports in subsequent years.
Yeah.
After the master plan was issued.
So basically technical
updates,
so that's, you know.
Pretty much, yeah. making a note about what to add to the agenda for the next meeting, so I don't lose track of it. Okay.
I think Tina has something.
Oh, sorry.
I just have one question. Is there any consideration being given to including any reference to the competition that was had for the future of Montpelier?
Yeah, we had, so Sustainable Montpelier Coalition attended a meeting about a month ago, maybe 6 weeks ago, and gave us a presentation of the finalists for the competition. They felt as though they all of the finalists had very great ideas to offer the city, so they gave us that presentation. It was really helpful, gave us a lot of food for thought. And it synthesized some of the ideas, you know, like, okay, if we're worried about parking, here are the different ideas that we're seeing in all of these different finalist proposals. So it's absolutely in the mix.
Because it was very interesting.
Very
creative ideas.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I don't know how exactly we're going to incorporate, but one thought I had is to invite Team Bridges to come give us a presentation as a way to see their thoughts on it. So thank you for the thank you for the idea. Any other discussion about city plan? I think we have a good idea for that. Okay. And then maybe we'll have more feedback for you before you do end up meeting with the Historic Preservation Commission, since they're not available tomorrow. Okay. So we can move into item 7, which is to review the minutes. Dare I say we're on track for an on-time adjournment.
Early.
Well, that would be ideal.
Yeah.
Okay, so March 25th or 26th, because there's conflicting dates here.
Interesting, yeah.
Let's see.
It would be the 25th.
Okay, so that's the first edit.
This just sounds kind of funny. Kirby had nothing to comment on except some emails that were going on. I don't remember what that means.
Yeah. Oh, because you were chairing?
That was me, basically.
What emails?
Outsourcing my comments to Mike.
Yeah.
I was like, I have nothing to say, but hey, weren't there some emails, Mike? And then Mike explained.
I don't think that the map is part of Google Docs. I think it's an extension of Google Maps.
Okay.
Because Docs are the document, but like, just in case that was.
Yeah, let's
anything.
Clarify. So where. I see, under the city plan header.
Yeah.
This is why we need youth on this committee.
You can't.
Show maps available on Google Maps.
She can tell us how middle school students walk to school.
I'm not quite sure if it's Google Maps, but it's not Google Docs.
Yeah, it was a Google Map.
We could just write, John showed the maps available through Google.
Yeah.
Just leave it browsed.
Yeah, because it's on the website.
Yeah.
So. Do I have a motion to approve the minutes with the edits being the change to the date and the reference to Google Docs?
You do.
Okay.
Second.
Any discussion? Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Okay. The minutes are approved. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
You do.
Aaron? Okay.
Or do you need a second?
adjourned. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.